Well, church, you may want to begin taking a good look around because our last Sunday in this space will be February 22nd. And we will begin to move downstairs in the hall for worship. I promise you, we're going to do the best we can, but it's going to be a bumpy ride. The chairs are hard. Where the cross would be, there'll be a basketball hoop. And it's not going to be the best of situations. But remember, a church is not about a place, it's about people gathering. And so I would ask you to just pray and stick with it and be faithful in those months ahead. And the results and what we will come home to will indeed be worth the wait. I just saw some pictures posted of St. Rayfield Church out in Bay Village. We are the only two churches who are building this year. St. Rayfield's, which is going to seat about 1,500 people, and ours will seat 320. I'm happy with 320. Amen. Too big, too big. But we had a great Sunday last week. Bishop Lennon was here with us, did a wonderful job, was very gracious and very supportive of the work that we're about here. And so we can be encouraged that what we're doing is a good thing, that it's from God. The challenge is sometimes things happen in God's time and not our time. And so we have to be patient and work through that together. But as we hear the scriptures today, we are confronted with two very different situations. We have Job, on the one hand, in the Old Testament, who is questioning what this is all about. He had it all. And he's coming to that point in his life where now everything is misery. Everything is terrible. Gloom, despair, and agony on me, is the old song used to say. But as he looked around, he couldn't see beyond the challenges and the trials that he was enduring to get in touch with the big picture. Remember, Job lost everything because of this conversation between God and between Satan. And God said, you know, I trust Job. Job is going to be faithful. You can do anything you want to him except harm the hair on his head. Little did Job have any idea that even his own family, his loved ones, would be taken from him. He would be left to ponder all of this reality of his life. And we've all been in those situations where there just seems to be no way out. The day drags on forever. You can't wait to go to sleep. And so you finally go to sleep and night comes and it lasts forever. And you say, when will the dawn come? But we just don't know what we want to do. And it becomes a moment where we have to kind of stop and regroup and rethink who we are and whose we are and what this is all about. What does it mean? How do we handle tragedy? How do we handle loss? How do we handle the uncertainty of our lives? We have to step back and try to put it in some perspective, a perspective that must include God's plan and God's care for us. God didn't bring us this far to leave us. God didn't bring us to this moment in our lives and to say, well, you're on your own now. That's not the kind of God we have. We have a God who is ever faithful, a God who is ever true, a God who promises to be with us even to the end of time. And we know as Job struggles, he eventually comes to some realization of how things are supposed to be, but not without some cudgeling from his friends who go after him, and not without his ranting and raving against God, and not without God saying, Job, remember, I'm God, you're not. And God sets Job back on the right path. And when Job comes to that realization, having gone through that trial, having gone through the storm, he comes to a new day where all the blessings he had are restored and more so besides. But he needed to step back. He needed to get perspective. He needed to regroup. We've all had those moments, I think, where we've gone into a room and we get in the middle of the room and say, why did I come in here? What was I about to do? What was I looking for? What did I need to be about? And, you know, and we unpolitically correctly, I think, call them senior moments. But sisters and brothers, I think we all know those are not simply senior moments. They happen to all of us. We find ourselves getting distracted, getting overwhelmed with so many things. We set out to do something, the doorbell rings. And so we tend to that and said, what was I about? We set out to take care of some business. The phone rings and we get caught up in an incredible conversation that leads us in all different directions. And when that's done, we simply have forgotten completely what we set out to do. We can get distracted along the way. And we too, like Job, need to step back and regroup. We need to put things back in perspective. And if you think it was just Job and just us who needed to do that, all we need to do is look at the gospel. And we know that Jesus had to step back and regroup as well. Jesus had to step away from the crowds. The scriptures tell us that he went off to a quiet place, a private place, to pray alone. Because Jesus knew he was becoming more famous than he ever thought. Jesus was experiencing fame. Jesus was experiencing the praise of the crowds. Oh, he was preaching and speaking about the word of God, the reign of God breaking into the world, but he was healing, and he was doing great things, and the people were clamoring after him. The paparazzi of his day wanted to know where he was and what he was about, and there was that temptation for it to go to his head. You remember what happens in the desert. And as Jesus is out there, we'll hear about that story in a couple of weeks as we enter into the season of Lent. The devil comes to Jesus and tempts him with all those realities. It tempts him to test God, that God would protect him. Tempts him against hunger and the passions of the flesh. Tempts him against vainglory. And Jesus stands all that in the desert. But remember in that desert scene, what does it say? And the devil left him alone for a while, until another opportunity presented itself. And while it doesn't say it explicitly in the scriptures, sisters and brothers, today is one of those days where Jesus was being tempted again by the devil. Because he could have let them raise him up. He could have let them continue to praise him and do all these kinds of things in awe of him, who was not only teaching and preaching, but was healing, doing things that no one else had ever done. How many of us, if we could reach out and touch someone and heal them and change their lives, I think it might go to our heads if we're not careful. Yeah, I'm all that. I can heal you. I can fix your problems. I can take care of your mess. Whatever it is you need, come to me, and I will do it for you. A real temptation. Because that's what people like us. People want to be around us. They all want to be our friends because we've got something they want. We've been there, church, you know. That's why when we win the lottery, we don't tell nobody. Suddenly we have more friends than we ever thought we could ever have. No. Jesus had to step back. And so the scriptures say he went off to pray alone. Because he had to step back and regroup and refocus his life. Jesus did not come to gain notoriety for himself. Jesus came to preach the good news. Jesus came to preach about freedom and a new way of life. Jesus came to fulfill the prophetic text of Isaiah that the Spirit of the Lord was upon him to preach good news, freedom to captives, sight to the blind, release to prisoners, to announce a year of favor from the Lord. It wasn't about him. It was about the message he was called to bring. And so he steps away to pray, to be quiet, and to refocus who and what he was about. And the disciples, they were crazy. They were just absolute crazy. Because they were liking being associated with this miracle worker from Nazareth. They were a friend of his. And everyone said, are you close to him? Yeah, I am. Yeah. What do you need? I'll talk to him for you, and then maybe we can work out a little something on the side. I know it doesn't say that in the scripture. But we know what human nature is all about, don't we? You know, you wash mine, I'll wash yours, and we'll all get through this together. And so the disciples come to Jesus, and they dare say, where have you been? Everybody's looking for you. the biggest lie in the scripture right there. They were looking for him. They wanted to know where he was, because without him, they were nothing. If they couldn't find Jesus to bring whatever it was that people were asking for, they were lost. And so they went out looking for Jesus, and everybody's looking for you. And Jesus said, you know what? Let's go to the next town. Let's go to the next town, because that's what I was called to do. Jesus is reminded in that quiet moment, no, I'm not to stay here. I'm not to get stuck in this glory. I'm not to get stuck in everybody paying attention to me. I need to go and share the good news with others who still need to hear it. And so Jesus' mission was first to go and to preach. Go and to teach. Go and to share that relationship that he had with God with those that he encountered. Only secondarily did he heal. Did he free people from their evils? Did he raise them up out of their sins and their struggles and their sickness? Only secondarily did he do that. But his first mission was to preach and share the good news. The reign of God breaking in to our world. We all have to sometimes step back and regroup. We have to take that time to refocus our lives on what is really important. Because there are so many demands placed upon us. Our children are needing all kinds of things. Even as we're caring for parents, they have things that they need. Demands of our job and our workplace, and not to mention what we're being asked to do in our church family to support and care for one another. Sometimes it can be too much, or sometimes we find ourselves having lots of gifts, lots of talents, lots of abilities. And so everyone keeps coming to us. And we, if we are not careful, and if we do not stay focused, we can start to think that it's all about us. That the job can't function without me. The church won't survive without me. So that pastor better be good to me, because if I walk, the whole place is going to fall apart. We can begin to think that the message and the mission is all about us and what we do and what we bring. And if we're not careful, we can forget that it's God who's working through us and using us as God's instrument. Jesus was God, but as St. Paul tells us, Jesus was God, but did not deem equality with God something to be grasped. He emptied himself and became one of us. It wasn't about him. He came to do the will of the one who sent him. And that's what we're being invited to do today, sisters and brothers, to consider how we can be faithful to the will of the one who sends us forth today. And not let a worldly ego get in the way. Because the scriptures today are all about egos. Scriptures are about egos. The ego that Job thought that he was all that, and why all this terrible stuff was going to him. The temptation to a worldly ego that was given to Jesus in this passage. What is ego all about? Ego is the temptation. The ego is the temptation to exit God out of our lives. Exit God out of our lives. To put God at the periphery. And place ourselves at the center and at the heart of everything that's going on. That's a worldly ego. But if we are about a divinely inspired ego, a spiritual ego, then we are about exalting God only.
I like that.
Exalting God only. We remember that it isn't about us, but it is about everything that we do, and everything that we are is about the praise and worship of God. And in the praise and worship of God, we are committed and we can do nothing but serve one another and be at the disposal of one another at the command of the gospel. Today's a day for us, if you will, to put our egos in check. To remember that it isn't about us, but it is about God and what God is asking us to do. And to focus again on what that gift is, what that ministry is, what that call is that God offers to each and every one of us. But to remember that it's not our decision. It's our response. It's our response to God's call. It's our response to God's invitation that must move us from a worldly ego and self-centeredness to an otherworldly ego in which we place God at the center of all that we do. Now, you and I know that emotionally and psychologically, we need a healthy ego. We need to have a good sense of self. We need to have a good sense of who we are and what we're about, so that we don't become so reclusive because of a sense of inferiority, or we don't become so overpowering because we think we're all that. A healthy sense of ego allows us to exalt God only. And in recognizing that God is the source and the summit of our being, it can allow us to do many ingrate things. It's what can allow us to say things like please and thank you, because we recognize none of this belongs to us. It's all a gift from God. Even the very breath in our lungs is a gift from God this day. And without that gift, we would be nothing. Today is an opportunity again to regroup, to step back, to go to that quiet place and pray. To go to that moment where we might put ourselves in check, or maybe more realistically allow God to put us in check and to remind us that I am God. I alone am God. And I will be your God for all time. Today, let's begin again. Let's begin to reflect again on who we're called to be and what we're about. We're only a month, 2 months now into the new year. It's not too late. Those resolutions that you did January 1st, bring them out again. Start over. Regroup. Step back. Refresh. Renew. And remember that who and what we're about is something greater than any one of us, but something to which all of us have been called by our baptism and by the grace of God given to us in Christ Jesus the Lord. Amen.
Amen.